So now moving to the background knowledge. So it's a reminder. We will take one step back and we will review the fundamentals of security that we will use afterwards in the package. So first, we will introduce the IoT protocols and the secure communication in order to understand what cloud providers look for and what they selected. Then we will review the basics of cryptography to understand the core of secure communications and IoT security. To be more specific, we will focus on X509 certificate. Probably you know this, but I think it's better to refresh our memory because these certificates are key elements for device-server authentication. This will be an important point. The last point we will focus on is the TLS secure communications, as TLS is the standard used to secure IoT communication. So first, the security needs for an IoT device. Since it's connected over the internet, it's important for service providers to make sure that the IoT device is trustworthy because they wish to protect their services, so what the user sees, what the user interacts with. They want to protect their networks, so preventing denial of services, providing a good quality and a good reliability. And finally, their brand, so their reputation, so the overall trust and related business from the end user. So to achieve this goal, so to be considered trustworthy, an IoT device must provide the following security qualities. Secure communication, so this will also include authentication. We will see that in details when having a look at TLS. We must provide data confidentiality and integrity, so this will be done through cryptography. And finally, we must ensure platform integrity at both device and firmware level. So here, the combination of STM32 and STSafeA will allow us to do so. So secure communication. So cloud services have selected to use standards-based secure communication protocols. So we have IoT nodes with limited resources, so they use constrained messaging protocols like MQTT and CoAP. This protocol, in turn, rely on transport layer security, TLS, for link protection in order to ensure secure communication. That's the key element. When we will use cryptography, what is important to keep in mind is that we will use two categories of cryptography, cryptography with one key and cryptography elements with two keys. So there are two main classes of cryptography used in IoT systems. One uses one key to protect data being transferred. In this case, we have a shared key, so known by the sender and the receiver. And this key, established between the sender and the receiver, will be used by the sender to encrypt the file, and the very same key will be used to decrypt the file by the receiver. So that's the secret key cryptography or symmetric cryptography. The confidentiality here relied on the shared key being kept secret. This is really important. So you can see the issue here. For secure communication to occur, you first have to share a key, and that may not be so straightforward and so easy. The other scheme has two keys, so we call it a key pair. So these are the two keys we have here, in red the private key, in green the public key. This scheme makes key sharing easier. One key is a public key and can easily be shared, there is no secret about it. It doesn't need to be kept secret, only the other key, the private key, must be kept safe. So the receiver will send a public key to the sender. The sender will use this public key coming from the receiver to encrypt the data. And in turn, only the receiver, because he is the only one having the private key, will be able to decrypt the data and retrieve the clear text. So that's very basic, but we need to keep it in mind because we will use both in the next slides. An important point is also digital certificate. So for this, maybe we can start with the definition from Wikipedia. So in cryptography, a public key certificate, also known as a digital certificate or identity certificate, is an electronic document used to prove the ownership of a public key. So this certificate, it will include information about the key, information about the identity of its owner, what we call the subject of the certificate, and there will be a digital signature of an entity that has verified the certificate's content. We call it the issuer, And if we trust this issuer, then we can trust the information contained in this electronic document. So when verifying a certificate, you verify the signature. And if the signature is valid and the software examining the certificate trusts the issuer, so the one who signed the certificate, then INCAT can use that key, this public key, to communicate securely with the certificate subject. So the most common format for public key certificate is defined by X509. Because X509 is very general, the format is further constrained by profiles. So these profiles are defined for certain use cases, such as the public key infrastructure, as defined in RFC 5280. This is what we are going to use. So what is important to keep in mind here is that we have a certification authority that will issue this digital certificate. This certification authority must be a trusted third party, and the certificate will certify the ownership of the public key by the name subject of the certificate. So probably something you already know, but again, let's keep it in mind. We will use it extensively. So if we take an example with Alice digital certificate, Alice will request her digital certificate to the CA, the certification authority. This certification authority will check that Alice is really Alice. They will generate and publish the certificate. So to generate the certificate, they will put information about Alice. They will put information about her public key and the public key itself. And finally, they will sign it with their private key, the private key of the certification authority, which is kept secret. Nobody knows that. But the public key of the certification authority is well known. There is no secret about that. An important concept we will use in our package is the certificate chain. So certificates can be chained. This means that you can get a certificate signed by a first issuer, and in turn, this issuer has a certificate signed by a certification authority called the root CA, because this one is the root of trust and needs to be trusted. Nobody else signs its certificate. So in our example here, we have Alice certificate with her private key. We can see that we indicate an issuer, which is an intermediate certificate. So this one we do not know, we do not trust him. But to verify Alice certificate, we will retrieve the public key, verify the signature. If the signature is correct, it means that this issuer is ensuring that Alice certificate is correct. But as we do not trust the issuer, we need to go one more step further in the chain, and we go up to the root CA. So the root CA is really the one we trust. This one we have in our database, so we can trust it, and we will retrieve its public key, verify the intermediate certificate, and this way we have verified the entire chain of certificate. So to do so, every device includes something called a root store. So a root store is a collection of pre-downloaded root certificates on their public keys, of course. And this root store lives on the device itself. All these certificates that we have in our root store are trusted. This is why we can verify the chain, because the top node, we trust it. So typically, if we take the example of your laptop, you don't need to download a root CA certificate because they are included in web browsers trust store, and sometimes they are even pre-installed on some operating systems. So on ST side, we already have a trust store on our laptops with some root CAs. So this allows your computer to be able to tell whether or not a certificate is invalid, because if its root certificate isn't on their trusted root CA list, then it will warn you that the certificate is not a trusted one. So for IoT devices, of course, we are not like laptops, so we cannot afford a huge trust store. So it's really important to select the root certificates we will embed. This we will see also later on. So transport layered security, now that we have seen the cryptography, we have seen the certificate. So in fact, the transport layer security is using X509 certificates and public key infrastructure. TLS will allow the client to authenticate the server. So this is commonly done in web browser. When you browse a website, your browser will verify the authenticity of the server, its identity. But it will also allow the server to authenticate the client. This is what we call mutual authentication. It will allow us also to establish a shared secret key, And this shared secret key will be a symmetric key that will be shared between the IoT node and the server. So the key exchange cryptography means can be Diffie-Hellman. This is the most common one. And the encryption we will use afterward can be AES, for instance. It will also ensure the message integrity. Of course, as we have an IoT device which is quite constrained with limited capabilities in terms of memory and processing, we don't need to support a full cryptography suite. So we can choose to implement a subset of protocols to suit the capabilities of the IoT device. So it means that the server and the device will agree on a subset of protocols. So when you build your IoT component, you need to know what the server will need, and you need to include this in your IoT device. So that's done for you in the package. We selected the profiles that are used by Amazon. So let's refresh our memory about the TLS protocol itself with a TLS exchange overview. So I have simplified the TLS protocol just to highlight the three cryptographic processes: the authentication, the sharing of the secret key, and the link encryption. So let's have a look at this process. First, we have a client, so the IoT node, sending the client hello message with the TLS version, the supported cipher suites, and the random. The server will respond, and with the TLS version, the chosen cipher suite, the random, and certificates are exchanged and signatures are verified. So the server will send its server certificate to the IoT node. The IoT node will verify the server CA certificate based on a root CA we have in our trust store. And in turn, our device will send in the device certificate to the server, so the server can authenticate the device. Then we have a Diffie-Hellman key exchange. This is used to establish a shared secret. So this symmetric key in gray here has been agreed based on Diffie-Hellman. So the idea with Diffie-Hellman is that you already have a key pair for an asymmetric keys. Your device key pair, public key, private key. So you will send your public key to the server will send you its private key, its public key, sorry. You combine it with your private key, the server combine your public key with its private key, and based on some mathematics that I can't really explain, that's far beyond my knowledge, you agree on a symmetric key. That's the key element. We have a key for encrypting and protecting our link. So now, all the exchanges we have can be encrypted with AES. So that's the way TLS brings security. First, authentication, then a key exchange, and finally, when the key is agreed, the symmetric key is agreed, we have encryption of the link, and we bring confidentiality this way.